It's fate that brings the greatest together at the same time. Testing each other, they make the impossible achievable. Innovation knows no bounds, and records tumble. In the mid-1970s, two unlikely rivals from Eastern Europe began a sporting and political war behind the Iron Curtain that changed their sport forever. When Romania's Nadia Comăneci scored the first perfect 10 in the history of gymnastics in 1976, she upset the equilibrium of a sport long since the preserve of the Soviet Union.
Faultless. Absolutely faultless.
It was the culmination of a five-year plan, and Romanian gymnasts were now taking on the world. The Soviets had never faced such a challenge, and it led to a rivalry that spilled out of the gymnasium and into the political arena.
We are not involved in politics. We didn't care. It's not our job. It's not our problem, the politics.
I wasn't fighting for anything else but the right of the kids, of my athletes, the right of the justice of the sport. And now they're calling me a traitor.
They made us say, I believe that I can win. The Russians are the best.
The rivalry saw the sport's most famous names go head-to-head.
The world is mine. Hello, I'm the best.
The footage that they cut, they were me and Olga. So it was like a really tough competition.
You know, I'm more focusing on the team than on Nadia. Who is Nadia?
The established order was turned upside down. Gymnastics would never be the same again.
The greatest team ever on Earth. The great Olympic world champion, the Soviet Union!
Wow! It was a big surprise. A lot of girls do better gymnastics than the Russians.
Winning is not everything. It's the only thing. Our dream in Romania at the time was to be the Russians, who were the best.
Capital of Romania, shows in these pictures how her citizens welcome the news of the relief of their country from the grip of the Nazis.
Following the Second World War, the Soviet Union launched a military and ideological offensive across Eastern Europe. Soviet Premier Joseph Stalin rebuilt the economies of many war-torn nations, turning them into communist satellite states. Romania was one such country, remaining under Soviet control until the late 1950s. With the war effort taking its toll, Stalin saw sport as a way of placating his people and championing Soviet supremacy.
In the Soviet Union, the government focused on developing sports. Sport was the face of the country. There were two aspects to it, ideology and money, and that's why we performed to such a high level.
For Stalin, the appeal of gymnastics was obvious, a sport demanding perfection in preparation and execution. The Soviet Union had been the leading nation in male gymnastics, so when individual female gymnastics became an Olympic sport in 1952, it was no surprise they dominated.
Any Soviet sports person had to be convinced in their ability to win. It was all about the Soviet Union. That was the idea they kept knocking into our heads. We must have confidence. We are the best. Others can't win because we are the best.
This win-at-all-costs attitude saw the Soviet Union women's team triumph in five successive Olympics from 1952. Larissa Latinina and Natalia Kuchinskaya became multiple gold medalists. And it was Kuchinskaya who heralded the sport's next revolution when she lit up the floor at the 1968 Olympics in Mexico. Gymnastics was transformed, and innovation was the key.
Other countries had a more rigid style. Our routines were more artistic.
The goal was to show something different, and we said, if you want to win, you have to show something new.
Always trying new skills like that nobody tried it before. It was always adventure, always fun. Now, although I killed myself so many times, trying them.
You didn't think about where you will fall or what will be after when you fall. It's easy, of course, to do gymnastics when you are young.
And it was a tiny girl from Belarus who soon became the pioneer of this new gymnastics. In Olga Korbut, the Soviet Union possessed the sport's first real superstar.
You know how many medals I have? I don't even count. A lot. I see this girl, Olga Korbut. She was wonderful. I'm serious.
In the 1972 Olympics, Olga Korbut captured the hearts of the world. Despite losing out to her compatriot Ludmila Turishova for the title of all-around champion, it was Korbut's acrobatic, endearing performances that turned gymnastics into a global phenomenon overnight.
I came to 1972 Munich Olympic Games unknown, completely unknown. Nobody knew me. But overnight, I became a huge star. I didn't know that.
I think that's everybody noticed. Not that it's hard not to notice because it was completely that change of the style, and she brought in all those innovations, that the first doing all those flips and tricks.
When Olga performed all her skills, of course we wanted to repeat the same thing.
They call me mother of gymnastics. It means something, yes, of course. I open a lot of doors to young generation.
But Olga had unwittingly helped open a door to one of the Soviet Union's communist allies. In the small town of Onesti in Romania, a teacher, Bela Karoli, and his wife, Marta, had founded an experimental gymnastics school.
We opened a new era. And the new era was bringing in the young generation. And very shortly, we did realize these young kids are having a tremendous potential, tremendous ambition, and the willingness to improve very fast. And of course, you know, then the Romanian Gymnastics Federation did realize, hey, these guys are doing something very different, but very, very spectacular.
And one girl stood out from the rest, Nadia Comăneci.
People, when they say my name, they just associated immediately with gymnastics and Romania.
Romania wasn't known for making automobiles or sending men to the moon. Romania had Nadia Comăneci.
She wanted to be a winner. She wanted to be the best. She wanted to shine. And she did not consider anything else that one would keep her back. I want to be the winner.
She's like a Mozart of gymnastics. She was a genius.
Romania had made little impression on previous international competitions, and they'd never threatened the all-powerful Soviet Union.
At first, the Romanians were really weak. They would come fifth or sixth or seventh, quite low. In any case, the Germans and other countries were stronger.
We don't have the possibility of selection from zillions of kids. We had just limited numbers, you know, to select from. So we have to adopt our methods, you know, to train them in a way that they can compete with the Russians.
By 1975, Nadia and her Romanian teammates were ready to take on the best at the European Championships in Norway.
I knew the European Championships is a big deal, but I knew that I was prepared.
I didn't even think about Nadia. And Nadia was like one of the gymnasts who came to compete. Of course, I'm sure the media was talking about her, I'm sure, but I didn't pay attention.
But the youngster's performance demanded attention. Nadia won a first all-around gold medal aged 13. And a rivalry with the Soviet Union had begun.
Everybody was, wow, look at this little kid, what she can do, you know, and she's better than the Russians.
She was almost perfect. And the way how she was performing surprised everybody at that time.
I did okay. I won. Yes, I said I did okay because I think I should have done better.
And that was even better winning because I said, oh, the Russians are not first anymore.
It was good because it's competition. Without competition, it's not even a sport. It's not interesting, right?
It was kind of a shock. Our people started to travel to Romania with cameras to watch them training. Nobody understood what was happening. We just couldn't believe it.
The Soviets did not want to recognize that an unknown young child beat them so categorically. How in the world they don't give us any kind of attention? The Soviets were surrounded by millions of photographers and interviews on every first page of every newspaper with somebody from the Soviet team. And nothing about us, no one word about us.
All that would change at the 1976 Olympics in Montreal.
Are you going to win all 5 medals?
Yes. I hope.
Ludmila Turishcheva and Olga Korbut were the most famous names that came out from the 72 games. And yes, it was a big competition because everybody, the footage that they cut, they were me and Olga. So it was like a really tough competition.
For me, it was to win Ludmila and to win Olga still. Because this girl still was names bigger than Nadia's name for me.
I don't think that Olga brought much more artistry to gymnastics. She was a great gymnast, don't get me wrong. It's just I think Nadia brought much more to the gymnastics.
On July the 18th, 1976, Nadia Comăneci stepped up to the asymmetric bars and gymnastics changed forever.
Your technique by that time was perfect. Even today, if you watch this exercise, her body position, technique was correct. It was sensation.
I was hearing everybody saying, oh, oh, but it was not such a big deal because it was like A, B, C, D of gymnastics. And then I heard a huge amount of noise and I turn around and that comes the scoreboard around with a 073, which was my competition number on my leotard, and a 1.00.
Ladies and gentlemen, first time in the history of the sport, a perfect 10 at the Olympic Games. Wow! At the incredible moment, that was just something that we never thought in our life that's going to happen with us.
I didn't know I was making history. I didn't know all of those things that happened when I got the 10.
I'm very proud of her. She did a very good job after me.
Nadia went on to record 7 perfect 10s across the competition, winning the all-around gold medal, as well as gold medals on the beam and bars. Her main Soviet rival, Nelly Kim, also scored perfect 10s on the vault and on the floor, but had to settle for the silver medal.
Of course, there was Nelly Kim got a 10 too on the vault, but see, nobody talks about it. Nobody cares about the second, which is, in a way, not that fair.
Honestly, I would not even think who was first or second. Because I look at this differently. I say, okay, Nadia got 10 on balance beam and even bars, first woman in history, and I was first in history who got perfect 10 on floor and the vault.
The first 10 on the floor.
But nobody presented this way.
The Soviets edged out the Romanians in the team competition to maintain their overall supremacy. But Olympic champion Nadia Comăneci and her compatriots had shaken their fierce rivals. They returned home to Bucharest as heroes.
The Romanian people were so proud. Everybody wanted to come to see the queen of the Montreal.
It wasn't just in the sporting arena that Romania's gymnasts had made an impression. The country's communist government had been following their progress very closely. Romanian head of state, Nicolae Ceaușescu, was determined his nation would not be a puppet state of the Soviet Union. And his independent foreign policy openly challenged their authority.
He had a conflict with the Soviets. He did not participate in the invasion of Czechoslovakia in 1968. The American president came to visit Romania. It was a big event. So Ceaușescu, very independent, he made Brezhnev very, very angry many, many times.
Ceaușescu was quick to realize the success of Nadia Comăneci symbolized his country. She was no longer just a sporting celebrity, but a political pawn.
After those Olympics, everything I had to go to, I had to win.
It's always pressure from the top that you need to have medals, medals, medals. You know, that was the style in Romania. But whatever the countries, the hatred was in the, between the countries, we don't know. We didn't know. And we didn't care.
It was harder and harder to fulfill all those expectations, and also harder and harder to fulfill their willingness to live their perfect, disciplined athletic life, because of all the disturbance which came from outside.
Political and competitive pressure came to the fore in Prague in 1977, as Nadia defended her European title. Tereshchova and Corbett had retired, leaving Nelly Kim as the main opponent.
In 77, I still felt like I have only one rival, which was Nadia.
Nadia swept the board with perfect tens once again. The Soviets were not so convinced.
First you work for your name, and then name works for you. That's what was for Nadia in 1977. She already was Nadia Comaneci, even she made mistake. This mistake some kind of was forgiven by judges.
When Nadia started to compete in national competition, they start to give her a 10, even she didn't do it. This is propaganda.
And the simmering rivalry came to a head in a way nobody expected, when Komenec went head-to-head with Kim in the vault.
Oh, beautiful vault.
Nadia was on vault, and then Nelly Kim comes on vault, and then the waiting for the scores was so long.
I had a bigger score, and then she had a bigger score, and then we tied. And in a few minutes, we were like going up and down on vault, like who's first, who's second.
They changed Nelly's score so she can beat Nadia on vault. And then the commentator for the Romanian television said, this is not fair, this is not right.
Suddenly, in the middle of the nowhere, we are called by the Romanian ambassador, come on here, everybody, everybody, screaming, screaming, screaming. I said, what's happening here? What's going on? He said, we gotta leave the arena immediately.
And Bella is like, says who? you just go and sit there. We have to compete here. He's like, he thought it was some kind of joke.
It's order from the president, immediate order.
The president was watching the competition on television. He saw that on vault, Nadia was cheated out of the gold medal.
So that was a reason for Ceausescu to say, okay, this is it, I had enough, take them out.
I told to the girls, ladies, we gotta leave. I'm not sure what's happening, what's going on, but we gotta leave.
And I remember I finished my beam, I got a 10, and then somebody just took me out of there, like right fast, got me out of the arena.
Well, for some reason, Nadia's just left the hall.
Get off, get off, get off. I say, what? Yeah, get off, out of the gym.
Having viewed the videotape of an earlier event, the Romanian delegation had withdrawn from the championships.
There was a private plane that they were sent from Bucharest, and we just went off, we left.
Wow, I said, that's not sportsmanship. That has nothing to do with us.
It was so bizarre, because it's like, we were supposed to do that, so we had to follow our orders, and we just went. And I think Nelly won most of the things.
In the following months, the Romanian government tightened their grip on the national gymnastics team. The girls were ordered to train in Bucharest and away from Bella Caroli. The decision proved calamitous. Comăneci was now a shadow of the gymnast she once was. Nelly Kim would win the 1979 World Championships. The Romanians backtracked. Bella Caroli was called upon once again. And Nadia in particular responded, winning a third successive European crown in 1979. The timing could not have been more important. The 1980 Olympics were on the horizon and in enemy territory, Moscow.
We are very concerned about the fact that the Olympics are taking place in Moscow.
I was going to the Olympics as the Olympic champion from 76, but I was going to a place where the people at home, they wanted to win.
Political relations between Romania and the Soviet Union had improved since 1977, and the Romanian gymnastics team feared they would now be subservient to their hosts.
Ceausescu was not that Western friendly anymore. He was very much a orthodox communist.
Despite the concerns, Romania still had Nadia Comăneci. For the Soviets, Elena Davidova now represented their best chance of securing all-around gold. and she had Nadia in her sights.
It would be me and Nadia. I was absolutely sure, I don't know, for some reason, I knew that I'm going to be on at finals.
I was confident that we're going to win. We're going to win this competition, particularly individual all around. There was nobody I could pinpoint at that time who could beat Nadia as an all-around performance.
The competition came down to the last two events, Davidova on the bars and Komenec on the beam. The Soviet went first.
So finally, she goes on the bars. She's performing all right. She's coming up perfect 10. And with that one, I said, this is highway robbery. This is the greatest injustice I ever seen.
A perfect 10 for Elena Davidova meant that Nadia had to score at least a 9.95 on her final discipline to become all-around champion.
I remember, but I wasn't thinking about anything. I was just watching, just empty. Everything is done.
The last event for Nadia, it was amazing. Great beamer, and she did a great beam routine. Hit the ground, yes! She's all-around champion.
An agonizing 30-minute wait followed. As the judges bickered, it seemed politics was once again the issue. Eventually, Komenec was awarded a score of 9.85. Not enough.
When the score came up, it was absolutely devastating to me and anybody else who knew the sport of gymnastics, what the score was. And of course, you know, there was a panel where the majority Eastern European countries, all Soviet-related, went together. And they gave that score.
I was absolutely convinced, you know, that she was cheated.
Good feeling. It was good. It was relief. It was happiness. And at that time, it was just competition over. And we were happy that it went well.
We were brutally, brutally handicapped and we brutally executed by that time the Soviet judging.
If you ask 90% of the world population who is Davidova, they will say, who? If you ask who is Nadia, you say, oh, Nadia Komenec. I mean, that was the difference. I mean, Nadia was Nadia, it was only one Nadia.
Komenec responded by winning gold on the beam and the floor. But once again, controversy reigned. Nadia's score was changed so that she shared a gold medal with her old foe, Nelly Kim, on the floor.
It was politic again, because when she finished her exercise, she got her score, nobody complained. Looks like it's okay. And then when I finished my exercise, suddenly Romania decided to complain. And again, I think it was politic, because Soviet Union and Romania at that time was the same bloc, same socialistic bloc, they were friendly, so okay. Then let's support each other, let's share a medal with these two ladies. I still think it should be my gold medal, but maybe I'm selfish, I don't know, you know.
But somehow it seemed fitting that in their final international routines, Nadia Komenec and Nelly Kim, rivals for the previous 5 years, should share the podium.
Both of us were standing close to each other and we were both tired. And we said, okay, finally we are ready to quit. Yes, we are ready to quit, we are tired. It was very friendly, nice talk.
Bela Karoli and his Romanian team returned to Bucharest as heroes for standing up to the Soviet regime. The Romanian government took a different view. Bela's behavior had embarrassed them. And in 1981, he, his wife Marta, and assistant Geza Pozar all defected to the United States. Nadia followed 8 years later. An era was over. The Romanian Revolution in 1989, followed by the dissolution of the Soviet Union in 1991, ended the greatest rivalry in gymnastics. The United States went on to dominate the sport, coached by Bela Karoli. But he will always be remembered for the school he set up in Onesti, for taking gymnastics to new heights in the mid-70s, for challenging the established order, and for making an enemy of a communist ally.
Of course, you know, there was always considered a great rivalry, and the great rivalry, of course, you know, elevated the sport greatly at that time.
Do you think you created a revolution in the sport?
Yes, because the Russians copied actually the Romanian system.
It was a Soviet Union team or gymnast who always won gold medal in women's gymnastics. And public kind of, I think, felt a little bit tired. They wanted to see new names, new countries. And when Romania showed up and Nadia appeared on the podium, of course, she dragged attention from public and media. And everybody probably was thinking, okay, finally we have somebody else who can compete against Russians.